Howdy.
Howdy. Hello.
Is this QuadJacks?
This is QuadJacks. Is this 11 Grover?
This is 11 Grover.
This is awesome. Welcome. Welcome back to QuadJacks, 11 Grover. May I call you Scott?
You absolutely can. I appreciate you guys having me on at during the World Series. That video has done great stuff for us.
Has it really? Tell us about it, Scott. You know, like you said, we last talked at the World Series of Poker. You were telling us about a project of yours that you're working on.
Yeah, I actually was just sort of on the spur of the moment. I wasn't really planning to do anything out there. And when we did that video, it was, just kind of off the cuff. Didn't really have anything to show or any of that kind of stuff. And yet, I've gotten a ton of feedback from it, and we're getting ready. We're probably only about a day or two away from announcing our Kickstarter page and some of those kinds of things. The real challenge that we run into this week, obviously, is that I don't want to be releasing our project during what is a pretty, heavy news cycle.
Speaking of the news cycle, Scott, we had quite a big one today, and we thought we were only going to learn about PokerStars and Full Tilt Poker. Instead, we got some news about UB and AP as well, and that situation. And most people, I guess most of the attention is being occupied by PokerStars and Full Tilt Poker. But we've also learned a bit more about what's happening with UB and AP. Are you not aware of this?
Well, I think just from looking at how it sort of all came out today in the document dump and so forth, it sort of looks like the DOJ was trying to head off sort of a bit of a PR kind of an issue or whatever, but they put the whole conclusion out there about PokerStars and Full Tilt, but then they released this document which isn't quite the same thing yet for UB and AP. But it does lay the groundwork for what's to come. And so, it sort of heads off all the people calling, the DOJ now and screaming, saying, what about us? And as you say, the numbers aren't quite as large as the Full Tilt Poker situation. Oops, hang on a second.
Mitt Romney.
that was QuadJacks TV there coming on with an advertisement.
We like Mitt.
Yeah, Mitt 2012. Go ahead, Scott. I'm sorry.
Anyway, we had come up with that number. Well, I guess it was last year. We had come up with that number of $55 million in player deposits for UBAP, and with about $5 million on hand. So we were already pretty certain that they didn't have any assets on hand there. And so then really the question was, what kind of deal could the DOJ make with them? It wasn't the same situation as Full Tilt in my mind, because Full Tilt really wasn't a soiled brand. It didn't have a lot of the intrinsic problems with structural company ownership, all that kind of stuff. So there was a lot of brand value there. There was a lot of rest of world players. I mean, it seemed to me to be a completely different situation. That said, now they've come out with a document that says, we're going to seize the assets. The assets really are a player database and the last balances, of all the players out there. So, what they're setting up is apparently some kind of a sale. They don't say that they have anybody on the line to make a purchase, but it's kind of hard to see them putting this kind of thing out there if there hasn't at least been some interest. And then you can make, sort of some conjecture, and you can, get to the place where there's a lot of people looking for first mover status here in the United States. UBAP was primarily a United States property, so most of the players were U.S.-based. So, you could possibly see some kind of a deal coming for that database. If it really is 6 million names and they're fairly current and were fairly active players on the UBAP site, then, yeah, there may be some value there.
Didn't the database get leaked, though, like a while ago?
Well, so, a database did get leaked, and it was leaked, looks like it was actually pulled in November of 2008 from the UB side of the property. So it's a bit dated, but it was 3.5 million names, and it was a very solid database. So I would say probably half of the database got leaked. But also probably didn't include, you know, any of the new signups from 2009 on.
Okay. Was anything ever really resolved about that since? I mean, did we ever find out who might have been responsible for that and why it was leaked the way it was?
Well, it was leaked in 2008, so
It was leaked in 2008?
Well, it was taken. I'm sorry, it was taken. Pulled in 2008.
Right.
So whoever pulled it in 2008, for whatever reasons that they pulled it, you know, we don't really know the answer to that. I have some strong opinions about that, because in this case with the Ultimate Bet side, and this database leak was an Ultimate Bet issue, there has been several individuals who have used internal company data, apparently, and I have to use that word, you know, I have to use a word that sort of couches this to make it clear that this is only my opinion, apparently to enrich themselves against the player interest. You know, there's at least four individuals that we're targeting in our film that look like they used data that could have been used to actually clean up the player situation out of the fraud. But instead, they all look like they enriched themselves and skated away. So I think that's what this database leak represented. But, you know, we don't know for sure.
Okay. Well, listen, let's get back to what was reported today and what that might mean for the future of the UB and AP. So what do you see happening at this point going forward? Realistically, maybe a little... ideally as well, idealistically as well.
Well, I mean, you know, if you look at it, you kind of had two company sort of waves going on. You sort of have this surface shell corp thing that was going on that was related to the mergers of the companies and the internal internecine struggle between the ownership groups, and, you know, AP finally taking full control of the room and shutting out the UB shareholders. And so you had that. That was the whole Blanca Games thing and Joe Norton's companies and all of that sort of stuff. And those are the companies, many of those companies are the companies that signed off on this agreement today. You have this underneath thing that's going on. In that first part, they actually jettisoned the UB shareholders. In the second part are all the Absolute Poker shareholders. And those are the folks that came forward in 2010 with the Norwegian reporting, where they were essentially saying that they were defrauded by, you know, Scott Tom and Hilt Tatum and the, you know, the primary owners of Absolute Poker for $250 million, was essentially a structure that they had set up as an ownership group where they could get paid an ongoing dividend payment from the site, but there was a value assigned to that structure of $250 million. So when the whole thing blew up, you know, those Norwegian shareholders, and I'm not really totally certain why it was set up in Norway, but it's probably a tax issue is my guess, but what happened was those folks ended up getting sort of outed to the Norwegian government, who said, hey, you owe us a whole bunch of taxes. They were no longer getting paid because Blanca Games, you know, when they shut out the UB side, also said, we're not going to send any more payments your way either. So now there's this underlying legal situation going on where the Norway folks are actually engaged in discovery and trying to depose people and trying to, you know, understand where the money went, the money trails, some of the, you know, Canadian companies and some of the Costa Rican companies, some of those kinds of things. And they have a solid claim on assets of the company. So in the today's release, there is a tiny little thing, and let me pull it up here real quick. There's a tiny thing that talks about how Avoin, which is a Portuguese company, and I won't get too deep into that, but that was part of that Norwegian sort of ownership structure. That group has not, you know, essentially settled here. That group actually is still laying claim to assets. So for players, you know, what they really, I guess, are, you know, they got a whole roll of hard six, I think, here. They got to hope that Preet Bharara, or however you say his name, is going to step forward and call them victims of some kind of Ponzi scheme or corporate fraud or whatever the heck, you know, he has to do to elevate them above the shareholders who probably have a priority claim on the assets.
Maybe Marco took a break. I'm not sure.
No, I'm here. I'm
digesting, Marco, are we?
I'm digesting, yes.
Fair enough. Thank God for the Norwegians. Continue.
Well, I mean...
I'm wondering, how much of this will figure into your cinematic project, Scott?
Yeah, I mean, I've really wrestled with that. And, I made a strong choice to just focus on the Ultimate Bet thing. I mean, I've always sort of talked about this as being, you know, really two separate things, and it still is. I can see maybe down the road doing something additional if our first project is successful. But to us, the Ultimate Bet story is really, it really underlies all this stuff. You know, I mean, one of the big premises that I keep making and I've made all along is that had we been able to do something in 2008 that really made a strong statement, that really, you know, brought Ultimate Bet to the floor and said, look, do the right thing here instead of what they did, which was, obscene. It's possible that the people inside Full Tilt would have said, look, players are getting a little militant here. We got to clean up our act a little bit. You know, maybe things wouldn't have been quite so run and gun and as loose as they were. And, you know, maybe the whole situation wouldn't have gone the way it did. Now, that's random speculation. I get that. But by the same token, the Ultimate Bet people really crossed the line first, and they crossed the line by just obliterating it by cheating players. So to me, that's always been the more interesting story. With Full Tilt and then later on with Absolute Poker, I mean, essentially they didn't even bother to do the hard work of actually sitting in games and seeing players' cards. They just reached into their accounts and took their money.
Yeah, how about that, huh? That is striking indeed. Scott, you were supposed to plug your film when I asked that. I mean, I love everything you've said, but we have a number of people listening, and I think I don't know if they all saw the interview we did, but in case they haven't, what are we to know about Ultimate Beat, working title, and everything else associated with it?
Ultimate Beat, Too Much to Lose, name of the project. I was calling it Working Title in Vegas. I've since gotten an opinion from an attorney that Ultimate Beat is enough under the parody category that it qualifies from a fair use perspective. And I think we're going to run and gun with that name, and we'll see where we end up. But so Ultimate Beat, the movie, is going to be a film about the cheating that took place at Ultimate Bet from the beginning of Ultimate Bet right until the time where cheating was discovered, and then ultimately the cheating and the player payouts were heavily covered up and under-refunded, and essentially the principals were able to get away with one of the biggest corporate frauds in poker, in the poker world at least. And so that movie is underway. We expect probably within the next day or two to announce. There is a website now for the project. It's Doublehead Pictures. Doublehead Pictures is the name of the production company. So doubleheadpictures.com is the website. I actually just finished building the Kickstarter page. I'm tweaking a trailer for the project that should go live in the next day or two. And, what we're looking for, and now I guess I'm probably going to do something I seldom do, but I'm going to beg a little bit here. Hopefully with all of this extra money coming into players' accounts, folks will be able to see their way to our Kickstarter page to throw maybe $10 at our project. One of the things we still need to do is travel to the East Coast. I want to get Nat Arum, who's agreed to do a nice long piece for the film. I want to shoot a couple of other folks that are on the East Coast, so hopefully we can get a little bit more funding for the project, but otherwise it's moving forward.
All right. Well, we're very happy to hear that, Scott, and we cannot wait to see it, and we hope to remain in touch. And thanks so much for coming on today. Best of luck to you and to the people with whom you're working, and it'll be fun to see.